Good morning, everyone. I'm Pastor Winston Watson, coming to you live on Thursday morning. I think it's the 29th of November, 2018. And I am here in Galena and Port Maria in this beautiful parish of St. Mary. Gail, good morning. You are... you are... a champion this morning. Good to see you on with us so early. And Jennifer, our sister Rife, praise God. Good to have you. And Satasha, wonderful to have you all on. There's someone else on that I'm not seeing. But I want to invite you to worship with us this morning for maybe a few extra minutes. I just want us to just get into a heart of worship. Amen. With Judy Jacobs. Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
And I struggled just to make it through the day. Suddenly I felt a holy reverence, and the pain inside began to slip away. Troubled hearts with healing.
Second song, but there's another one that I would like us to just engage with.
God, our desire tonight is that you would give us a heart of worship. Lord, let our lives have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God. David, who was known as a man after God's own heart, who stated in Psalms 42, as the deer pants for the water, so pants my soul after you, God. I thirst for you, Jesus.
I'm running after you. Healing, Lord.
2018. My heart is heavy with challenges this morning. You know, I've been working. I don't know if you could have seen my hands when I raised them, but I'm covered with glue. But my heart just remains heavy this morning for our brothers and sisters in Christ that are victims and are hurting and, you know, are misused and abused across the world. We are Christians, and yet we don't treat our Christian brothers as we ought. And that challenges me. And it seems that, and I'm going to rather speak heart to heart with you this morning. Yes, you know what the topic is, but I'm going to speak heart to heart with you this morning that don't misuse and abuse the people that are the children of God around you. You will have to give account. You know, you may have all the money in the world, you may have everything you need. Let's see what Gail just said here. Ava Grace has her first sets of scans today following the end of her treatment. Woo! Hallelujah! We're believing that Ava Grace is just going to come back with a great report. Amen. But when you think about youngsters like Ava Grace and people that are in need and, you know, the things that we do as Christians to each other, we ought not do that. We ought to be working on issues like Ava, and we ought to be working on issues like the challenges in the world that so many people are going through. Amen. And so this morning, I worship. The few songs that I played were really to just get my mind geared toward God and to get all of us at the place where we can hear from Him and walk in Him. Brother Brent Dane, good to have you on with us. all the way from Kentucky. Hey, my brother Brent and his beautiful wife there in Kentucky. Good to have them as friends, amen. Joined him on his live broadcast the other day and really enjoyed it. But I'm talking about our life in Christ and the ability or our ability to live like our Father. You know, Jesus Christ came on the earth and he lived like his Father. He lived like the God that he came from. And so this morning I want to focus on the ability of God in you is limitless. The ability of God is limitless. Why do I say that? But yet I look around the world and I see hunger and distress. Well, I look in the church and I see cancers and I see, you know, I see the challenges. I see the lies on other Christians. I see the gossiping in the body of Christ. I see, you know, the hate mongering. I see the division and the discord. I see all of this. You know, I see the fact that men and women are being defeated every day, and yet we call ourselves Christians. See, all of that is evidently there. I cannot deny that these things exist. However, there is a greater God. There is a greater one that has given us an opportunity to live above these things, to live in a greater atmosphere of his presence, to live in a place where we are successful, not just naturally, not having a nice bank account and having a nice home and having beautiful children, but having the peace of God, walking in the power of God in the earth, and giving the world the opportunity to see the awesome presence of the sons of God. Woo! The Bible tells us that the whole earth groans and travails, awaiting the manifestation of the children of God. What does that mean? We are already here. So what does it mean, awaiting the manifestation of the children of God? You see, the world, the nature around us, the atmosphere around us is awaiting you and I stepping out and truly exercising, acting out the authority of God's kingdom in the earth. We are not just ambassadors in name only. We are not just people called Christ followers in description only. We are not just aberrant people, you know, that just decided to go, you know, into a ditch somewhere. We are a new breed of believers, and I keep using that term. We are a set of people that believe God. We are a set of people that take the word of God seriously. We are a set of people that love the family and friends around us. We are a set of people that will not put up with the nonsense and the foolishness and the attacks of the enemy against us. We know we are, in essence, a divine injunction in the earth. We are instruments of peace. We are instruments of righteousness. We are instruments of the glory of God manifesting itself in our church, in our communities, in our homes, in our families. We are instruments and weapons of the kingdom of God that has been sent into the earth to accomplish God's own purpose. That's who we are. And we have to begin to realize, walk in that new creation reality. You know, you hear me say that time and time again, and you might think that I'm just a stuck record. No, well, I'm not. I'm wanting you, believer, to grow up into the fullness of this stature of God, to know him. In the book of Ephesians, on the fourth chapter, it says that he has sent gifts into the body of Christ so that we may grow, that we'll be not tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, but we would grow in the fullness of the understanding of who we are in this Christ Jesus. Who we are as this body of believers, my God. And Satasha uses a scripture that I love to use. We are his workmanship, created unto good works. You know, the word created there is actually a word that means fitted. Many of you, you know, ladies, maybe you have been to a particular occasion and you did not go and you did not buy an off-the-shelf dress or off-the-shelf outfit. You went to a seamstress and you had the seamstress. Many of you, when you got married, you did this. You know, you had a seamstress actually measure you, and you had the seamstress actually create men, same thing. You had the seamstress, or you had the tailor make your particular item of clothing for that occasion. God has tailor made your world. God has tailor made the giftings that He has bestowed upon you. God has tailor made the situations of life that are around you, and He has tailor made you to handle, to deal with, and to be effective in the things that contend with you, the things that come against you. And many times the things that come against you, they're there to thwart. They're there to shut you down from being effective, not just in your life, but in the lives of your of those in your community, in your community of influence, in your community of fellowship. And when you are shut down in that community, then you sit back and you allow the enemy to do what he wants to do, to have a heyday in the lives of people, to have a heyday in your family. Come on, let's take a stand today. Let's draw a line in the sand, amen? And let's say, no, we will not allow you. No satanic influence, no negative principle, no incursion of the enemy. We will no longer allow you to take over our mind, to take over our finances, to take over our life. We are like our Father, greater than the great. We are like our Father, stronger than the strong. We know that there is healing in this house today. And the house is not the building that I'm in. The house is the place, that spiritual place, that wherever you are in the world, you and I now, we are in the house of worship. Amen? We are at a place where God has the opportunity to use our words and use our heart and use our minds. There is no limit to what you can do, my friend. There is absolutely no limit. He doesn't want us, if Ephesians 4 verse 13, any longer to be tossed to and fro and tossed about by every wind of doctrine. He wants us to grow up in the full stature of the Jesus life. Did you hear what I just said? The Jesus life, not the sentient life. We all have that. We all have the touch and feel life. We all feel heat and cold. Some of us are where we are in the United States. We are enjoying snow. And thank God we don't have snow in Jamaica. but when I was in the U.S., and you know, many of you know I lived there for many years, I enjoyed snow. I made my snow angels just like everybody else. I went, you know, with a little toboggan and as a child and had fun on the hillsides. I enjoyed myself in that place, but right now, God has prepared us spiritually in the places that we are. We are greater than the issues that confront us. We are greater than the issues that confront our family. We are greater than the issues that confront our world, because God is in us. As I read Ephesians 4:13 a while ago, He doesn't want us to be any more children, tossed around with every wind of doctrine. He wants us to be settled on His word, to let the Holy Spirit lead us, to let the Holy Spirit open our understanding through teachers, that we're not here to coerce you and to take, you know, goods and services from you, or to influence you in a way to titillate, that is to excite your emotions about something. What we are here to do is teach you the word and open your understanding to the mighty God that you serve. And not only to the mighty God you serve, but you realize that you are in an army. You have been conscripted, you have been drafted into an army of saints across the world to make a difference in this natural world. You are the supernatural enemy of the world system this morning. You're the supernatural enemy of the satanic kingdom, the kingdom of darkness this morning. You are the more than conquerors that God has established right where you are to deal with Southeast Asia, to deal with the Middle East crisis, to deal with the African continent and the issues that confronts those children that today are enslaved in the Sudan, in the Sudan North and, you know, and Southern Sudan. You are the ones that God has called to intercede against Boko Haram. You're the one that God has called to intercede against ISIS. You are the one that God has called to intercede against all of the ills of the world. You know, we want the United States and its military might, or we want a coalition of the NATO forces. You know, but it is you, my friend. You are the divine legislators in the earth. You are a part of the army of heaven. You are the ones that God has put a word in your mouth. My God, did you hear what I'm saying? God has put a word in your mouth and a weapon in your hand to handle the issues of the world today, to handle the issues of the United States of America and the challenges in Los Angeles, to handle the challenges in Florida, to handle the challenges in Dayton, Ohio, to handle the challenges in Detroit, Michigan, to handle the challenges in Tulsa, Oklahoma. You are the one that God has called. You are the one that Nebraska needs today. You are the one that Toronto needs today. You are the one that Mr. Trump needs today to pray for him, to lift him up. You are the one that Melania Trump requires in her life. You may not know her personally. You may not know Mrs. Holness in Jamaica, or, you know, the Honorable Prime Minister of Jamaica, Mr. Holness, or the leader of the opposition. You may not know Theresa May personally, the Prime Minister of, you know, of Britain. You may not know, you know, Mrs. Merkel personally, the Chancellor of Germany. You may not know, you know, the head or the president of France, who just visited Burkina Faso in Africa. You do not know, you know, I cannot pronounce his name, Cheng Chao, or whatever his name is, the leader of the Chinese Republic. You don't know these individuals, but you know God. And God has given you the might and the right to pray over the world. You have jurisdictional rights that God has given you to handle the situations in Washington, D.C. this morning. To handle Congress. To handle what happens in the United States Supreme Court. To handle what happens in our Supreme Court. To handle what happens in our House of Parliament, in the Senate in the United States, in the Senate in Jamaica, in the House of Lords in London, England. You may wonder, well, how do you know all these things? How are you able to just recite these things out of memory? Well, I've studied this over the years. I love politics. I love my people of the world. I love the nations of the world. And I know that God is calling you. Morning Prayer Live is not just there for us to pray for ourselves and for us to pray for our families. But God is positioning you. You know, it may not be a message that excites you this morning. It may not be a message that may tell you, well, you're going to receive $1 million. It may not be a message that tells you that, you know, you're going to receive a big house. Just confess it. but it's a message that says God is calling you to a higher place. Zion is calling you to a higher place this morning. Zion is reaching out to you this morning. Zion, the government of God, the governing reality of God is calling you to walk into governance, my friends. Step in and begin to address what God has created you to deal with in the earth. Gail has stepped out and Gail has addressed this young lady's life, Ava Grace. And many of you, I don't know if you know this, but when the fire in London several probably months ago, I was online with Patricia Harper. And there she is, as a matter of fact. She just said something. I was online with Patricia Harper. And, you know, Patricia, on several occasions, Patricia Harper would text me in the middle of the night, her night, and in the middle of my night, you know, she would text me and said, well, I just heard ambulances, I just heard this, or I just heard that. And she is there interceding. I wonder how many lives were preserved because Patricia Harper prayed in her city of London. And others too, I would know. I wonder how many lives you have saved because you've prayed over a particular nation. Zion is calling you to a higher place. Zion is summoning you this morning. Zion has issued a summons to you to come into the court of praise, to come into God's court of worship. You, this morning, my friends, you are called to fulfill your purpose. The ability of God in you is limitless. It depends on you. It depends on what you have decided you want to be and you want to do. Let's not just sit back and go to church on Sunday morning or on Saturday morning. Let's not just sit back because, and let me point this out, people will criticize you. People will try to obfuscate, or people will try to come against what, you know, you stand for, but stand for Christ. Stand for truth. Stand for righteousness. Stand for holiness this morning. Amen? Take a stand. You see, and you may not realize it. You know, I think about Tina, and she didn't really share a lot of details with me about this. But I have an idea that Tina is very involved in her community. That's Tina Durbin, is very involved in her community. And so many of you, you go into shelters, you go into the streets, and you minister, you serve, you encourage, not because you get a crown on your heads in this world, nor you get some kind of recognition. But you do it because there is a Christ in you. There's a hope of glory in you. Be no longer children, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. If you want to grow up in the full stature of Christ, that ability belongs to us. We can understand that you have become a partaker. You and I, we have become a partaker of the very nature of the Father. And that everything Jesus purchased by his ransom, his shed blood, everything in the redemptive work is available to you and I. It's available to you. It's available to you. It's available to you. You're not perfect. By no means. I know you have challenges. I know you have hurts and you have pain. I know there are so many things that are happening to you in your life. Sister Patricia Harper has some challenges there in England, you know, immediately around her, right there in her family. And the enemy wants to use it to shut her down. The enemy wants to use it for her to sit back. The enemy wants to use it for her to become benign, just sit there and do nothing and be a do-nothing Christian, be an ineffective Christian. But I remember the day, and you may not know this, but Sister Patricia Harper have been friends since second grade. I have known her, and in second grade we were inseparable. Nobody, no teacher, nobody could separate us in our classroom. And that's the kind of, so I've known her for beaucoup years, amen? But I remember recently when we got together on Facebook, I could feel her heart. My God, what about you? Can you feel the heart of the people around you? Can you feel the coalescing or the holy convocation or the assembly of the Gales and the Tinas and the Patricias and the Rosemaries, that we are not here just to engage in a nice Facebook live program? We are not here just to sit around and feel good because we play a nice song in the morning, but we are here as emissaries of the kingdom of God to declare in the world. Junior 2A. She remember, I don't remember that. We are here as emissaries of God. You ladies have memories like elephants. You forget nothing. But this morning, let us hold fast to what God has given us. That redemptive work and all that comes with it is for us. By the way, same thing with Rosemary. She and I have been friends since primary school, you know, in Jamaica also. When I went to Melrose Primary School in Kingston, my God. So I've known some of these people for a very long time. My God, my God. Some of you I've known in college, amen. But God's work, there is ground for you to now break up. There's ground for you to now begin to farm. There is no place, my friends, there is no place for you to remain weak and defeated. There's no place and no more in your world an opportunity for you to lay back and say, well, I can't do that anymore, or I can't do that at all. There is no place for you to step back and say, no, I can't take a stand. You have to take a stand. The unfortunate thing is that I see so many Christians. They will see what's happening in the lives of others, and they will not take a stand. They will not correct, and they will not deal with the issues. There is no ground for a man to be always talking about his lack of faith and his lack of this or his lack of that. For of his fullness, the Bible says, listen to this word. This is the scripture. For of his fullness have we all received, and grace upon grace. For of his fullness have we all received, and grace upon grace. Take a stand. Draw a line in the sand. Say, I am no longer in retreat mode. Ha ha! Woo! Can you imagine a position like that? I am no longer in retreat mode. I am now taking new ground. I am no longer in retreat mode. I am no longer in just standing in one spot mode. I am now on the offensive, and I am taking ground. I am heading into the court of my opponent, and I'm going to get some balls into that net. Amen. I am not going to sit around and wait for victory to come. I am someone, you are someone that walks with victory on your lips, walks with victory in your feet, walks with victory in your hands. You are a vessel of victory this morning. My God. Let me read that again. For his fullness, for of his fullness have we all received, and grace upon grace. What does grace mean? Ability. Grace, the word charis, the Greek word charis, the ability, the anointing, the anointing of God. You've received it. The presence of God. To handle it. In the mind of the Father, you are already complete. You are in the mind of God, you are complete in Him. who is the head of all principality and power. You are complete in his completeness. I'll never forget the thrill that Ephesians 1 verse 22 and 23 gave to me when I first read it and I began to pray it. And he put all things in subjection under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is the body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. We are the body of Christ. We are the feet of Jesus. I think I need to read it again. And he put all things in subjection under his feet. We are his feet. So all things are in subjection under us. And he gave him to be over all things to the church, which is his body. He is over the body of believers called the body of Christ, the church. My God, we ought not be in retreat mode. Yes, Sister Patricia. Amen. Karando rebaba sikurababande leboboboshiai. We are the part of the body that is running things for God. And he puts all the forces of darkness under our feet. One of us could chase 1,000, the scripture says. And then it says two could put 10,000 to flight. The ability of God, and let me point this out, a marriage is just like that. That's why the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 5 speaks about the marriage covenant. Because the marriage covenant is akin to the covenant that Christ has with us. When Brother Brent Dane gets together with his sweet wife, when they put that ring on each other's finger, I think her name is Laura. When Brent and Laura Dane got together, Brent by himself had an ability to deal with spiritual issues and to deal with natural issues. But when they became Mr. and Mrs. Dane, when they joined together naturally and then supernaturally, they not only had the ability to deal with, let's say, 1,000-fold issues, but now they are, when they come together, 10,000 times more powerful than they ever were by themselves. My friend, you and I together this morning, you and I all over the world, wherever you are, we are 10 million, probably a billion times more powerful than we were when we were just in our living room, just in our kitchen, just in our car, by ourselves. Because Morning Prayer Live has coalesced, has created a convocation of saints, that when we come together, we are decreeing just by coming together. We may just listen to a song, we may just listen to a few verses, but when we come together, immediately we create a body of intercession for the world around us. Immediately we create a body of intercession for the challenges that affects our brothers and sisters wherever they are in the world. Amen? We affect, and we have to realize that. We have to realize how powerful we are in the Christ that we serve. The forces of darkness is afraid of you. The forces of darkness is in trepidation and in agony because of who you are this morning and because of who you're finding out that you are. You see, what are we going to do with scriptures like 2 Corinthians 3, verse 4 and 5? And such confidence, listen to this verse, and such confidence have we through Christ to Godward, that we are sufficient of ourselves to account anything as from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God. There is a God that has carried us and keeps us. My God, I didn't realize the time is running off so much. I just have a couple of more points to make. My God, my God, my God, my God. Woo! Exactly right, Brother Brent. 10,000 times more powerful. And when Brent and I get together, when Gail and I get together, when Brent, Gail and I get together, when Brent, Gail, Patricia, Rosemarie, and Tina, and all of you that are online with us, Anna, you know, and Licia, when all of us get together this morning, my God, kingdom citizen, when we all get together, 10,000 times 10 million times, a billion times more powerful in the earth. Why do you think that hurricanes don't hit Jamaica the way it hits other places? When we are mobilized, why do you think that the calamities don't hit your family? You may have some issues, but why do you think certain things don't come to your doorstep like it comes to another's doorstep? Because you are powerful. Because you're awesome. And the kingdom of darkness knows it. The situations of life know it. Cancer knows it. Amen? No matter what neuroblastoma or what kind of toma or whatever oma it is, it knows how formidable you are. And though it may come to your door, you have the right to speak to it and to tell it to return, to leave. And you can escape from its clutches this morning. My God. You know, am I speaking strangely? I dare say not. I'm speaking the oracles of God. I'm speaking the word of God. I'm speaking what God says. Amen. Yesterday, I did some work here in the building. I actually put up some wiring for our security system. And I've seen many years ago, many years ago, I saw a young man do something that I didn't know could be done with these wires. And when I decided it, I went to a store and I saw the same thing he was using. And so I bought it. And so yesterday I used it. Now, my hands, like I said, if you look, I don't know if you can see it, but my hands and my fingers are full. You can see the glue all over my hands. So I didn't do it the way he did it. I mean, I got so messed up with it yesterday. But nevertheless, I accomplished what I set out to do. So sometimes we may not know every nuance of the word. We may not understand every revelation in the scripture. And our hands may get a little glue over it. We may get something sometimes, you know, get a little messy. But guess what? We are going to do what God says is within the capacity of the believer to accomplish. My God, my God, my God. I want this word to sink deep in your spirit today. It means that everyone, it doesn't mean preachers only. It means that every one of us, each one of us, we are ministers. We have been made sufficient as ministers of the new covenant. Woo! We have his sufficiency. We have his ability. It staggers our mind, I'm sure, and staggers the mind of the world when we get the right translation of Luke chapter 24 and verse 49. But tarry ye in the city until you be clothed with power from on high. This was Jesus' message to the disciples before he ascended. He wanted them to be clothed with power. The correct word for power means ability. Now he says, I want you, to be clothed with ability from on high, the Father's ability. You can hear him say, now you will be able to stand and understand the message that we have given you, he and his Father. And let me end with these three statements. You will have the ability to know what the new creation means. You will have the ability to enter into the fullness of the divine life. I will repeat it, or repeat them. You will have ability to be my witness, to heal the sick, to cast out demons, and to use my name against all the forces of darkness. My friends, let me repeat that. You will have ability to know what the new creation means. You will have ability to enter into the fullness of the divine life. You will have ability to be my witness, to heal the sick, to cast out demons, and to use my name against all the forces of darkness. Friends, these are indeed the days of Elijah. These are indeed the day and the time when God says, let us do what he has called us to do. Amen. You have a wonderful day. May Christ be formed in you, and may all that you have in your heart, all that you have in your heart to do, come into fruition in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Clothed with ability this morning. Clothed in the righteousness of God this morning. Hallelujah.
My heart was heavy, and I struggled just to make it through the day.
No more struggle. No more struggle.
Suddenly I felt a holy reverence, and the pain began to slip away.
There is restoration in this place.
Right away, I knew that something happened.
Yes, Gail.
Reflected in expressions on each face. Taken by surprise, I felt his presence, and I knew that this must be a holy place, 'cause there is healing in this house. There is healing.
Power and in the majesty of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.